or that sort of thing.
He wants to do more. He gives his idea. But they, because of financial constraints, he cannot do this, like, no way you can do this, like, no way we can make your album this way, like, no, you can't do your design this way, you can't do this way, we can't have this CD here, we can't add an extra song, we can't go re-record, those kind of things. That frustrates him.
Sudirman's early hits demonstrated that he had both a special sense of himself as a Malaysian artist, but with a passion to experiment and stretch his range.
Lagu-lagu arwah batu dia sebenarnya adalah bertemakan rakyat, kedepan masyarakat, kampung. Bukan saja bertemakan patriotik. Juga diselitkan lagu-lagu cinta. Semua orang akan suka setiap lagu-lagu arwah batu dia sebab suka menghiburkan semua orang dari segenap lapisan masyarakat Cina, Melayu ke India ke.
In the midst of all this, Sudirman finally graduated as a lawyer. And soon after, he and Kay decided to marry.
I think just a few years when they got married. It's quite early for a young guy and for an up-and-coming artist then.
It was a measure of Sudirman's new fame that his wedding was a big event in Kuala Lumpur's social calendar. As his star rose at EMI, Sudirman found a powerful and sympathetic backer in the shape of a new manager, Mike Bernie Chin. Chin had a special understanding of Sudirman's potential as a star.
Sudir and Mike fed off each other in terms of creativity. Sudir would have all these ideas, and Mike would have to, like, make it practical, make it concrete.
After a modest success at live shows and performances, the dynamic duo set their sights on the top prize. In 1980s Kuala Lumpur, one venue more than any other had an exclusive and elite status. So exclusive that no Malaysian singer until then had had the opportunity to perform on its stage. The Hilton Paddock was strictly Western acts only.
When you think about paddock, you're talking about fine dining. You're expecting expatriates to come up, you know. This is the, of course, the old Kuala Lumpur Hilton. Paddock has always invited artists from abroad. Mike and Sudir wanted to break that.
Backed by Mike Burney, Sudirman set about conquering the paddock.
Mike tells Sudir, you can do it. We have the kind of creativity, you have the voice, and I tell you the amount of time the both of them spent to create that repertoire.
Sudirman had a very good idea how to succeed at the paddock. He knew that it was not enough to be a great singer. Everything hinged on performance. And the more spectacular, the better.
He was not like your run-of-the-mill Malaysian singer. He did things in a big way. He had big vision, and he saw things in a different way. For him, a show would be a full ensemble of musicians, backup singers, dancers, the works.
He could do everything, make people laugh, you know, do stand-up. If you wanted him to sing a rock, he would come up with this, you know, very rockish outfit and go into a rock mode. And then you want to do the Budak Kampung bit, he would also do that. Here is the true entertainer. He was somebody who, when he did a performance, could see everything about the performance, whether it was the lighting, to the music, to the costume, to the makeup, you know, to the stage set, everything.
And it all paid off. Sudirman's gigs at the paddock proved a spectacular success.
Paddock is a benchmark to set for Malaysian live performances, and Sudir was the leader.
Sudirman's famous performances at the paddock crystallized everything that made him special. His mastery of Malay traditions smoothly combined with Broadway styles. Sudirman was always a thorough student of world music.
When I had the opportunity to visit his home, I saw his library. He had all the musicals there. Cabaret, West Side Story, Cats, everything, all on video. He watched all this. He studied it. He learned, he studied. His mentors were Sammy Davis Jr., Joel Grey, the Nicholas brothers. So he had his history.
For Sudirman, the conquest of the Hilton Paddock was a step change. He was now on his way to stardom. Now, he needed to broaden his appeal. The key would be television, which in the early 1980s had a rapidly expanding market in Malaysia.
I was looking for a host to do a weekly entertainment program called Puspa Warna. There was this assistant producer came and told me, Mr. Jack, you're looking for a host. Would you be interested in somebody that I would like to recommend to you?
It was to be a momentous encounter.
Then she opened the door in the room. Then I see a little fellow there. Sudirman.
But the diminutive Sudirman thought big, very big. He would not be content merely standing in front of a camera and singing. He wanted to control the entire process.
He gets involved into the nitty-gritty details, even like the follow spot. He's got to have it like that size just up to here, you know? If he finishes and he wants it shut down and blackout, it's like he counts for you. 3, 2, 1, and that's it. And how long it blacks out, he also tells you that. He wants it for 1, 2, 3, and you open up again. And you open up to where exactly? That's Sudir.
He is one artist that I worked with, like I said, highly creative, with a lot of visualization power. He also does this storyboard for his songs, and then he can explain, you know, how the process of producing a song in studio. You put the props like this, you have this kind of angle, these kind of things.
You always ask, hey, do you think the producers will be angry if I tell them what to do? Because these people sometimes they say they are not that creative or they don't know what I want.
Sudirman's hands-on approach paid off. He was voted best TV entertainer 2 years running. Sudirman had grasped the secret of success in Malaysia. In this multicultural nation, it is crucial to speak or sing to everybody, regardless of race. This meant he needed to master not only Malay, but Indian and Chinese musical styles.
Sudir has a photographic memory and he's so intelligent. So when he wants to do a Chinese song, a Cantonese song, a Mandarin song, I'll get our assistant production manager, and he reads Chinese. He will romanize the sound and then he will coach and work with Sudir on the intonation. And with the Tamil songs, he has Nadan, his valet, his bodyguard, his PA, and he will help.
But what made him special as a performer was his restless ambition. Now he took a bold new step. He began to look beyond music, to cinema. At the beginning of the 1980s, Malaysian star Sudirman began to look for new worlds to conquer. He had mastered the recording studio and television. He was restless, again. But as Sudirman's star rose unstoppably towards its zenith, all was not well with his marriage to his muse, Kay. His closest associate, lyricist Habsa Hassan, noticed the growing rift.
And I can sense something is not right somewhere. You know, before they were used to come and to go around together, and, you know, slowly I don't see her around.
Habsa had a good idea what was going wrong. For Sudirman, career took precedence over his private life.
He was very busy with his recording, his shows, and at the same time, he was also doing his chambering in Mentakab, somewhere in Pahang. And he has to commute almost every day from Pahang to Kuala Lumpur. And then when he comes back, he has to start doing his rehearsal. Being Sudirman, he is very committed to his work. Personally, I feel it's a situation that affected their marriage life.
Sudirman was not going to let his domestic problems get in the way of his ambition. He had conquered in rapid success the once exclusive Paddock nightclub, the recording studio, and television. Now he turned his attention to the movies. And as usual, it would be on his own terms.
I said, Sudir, would you act in a film, you know, if I had the script? And he said, yes. With hesitation, and I was pleasantly surprised. But he said, on one condition, I want to translate
the script from English to Malay. And I asked him why.